It's Egypt's biggest excavation in 100 years. Archaeologist Dr. Zahi Hawass is here to explore the last great tract of wilderness in the Valley of the Kings. His mission, to find a missing tomb from Tutankhamun's royal line, filled with treasure.
We are looking for a royal tomb hidden in the silence and the mystery of this unique valley.
Finding an intact tomb would be absolutely spectacular, mind-blowing.
It would be the biggest thing in the history of Egyptology.
150 workers will dig for 6 months.
We really haven't seen anything on this scale before.
In temperatures over 100 degrees, they need to move thousands of tons of rock and rubble in sweltering desert heat. And they'll do it all by hand. To realize Zahi's ultimate ambition,
it is my dream to discover the tomb of the famous magical queen, Nefertiti.
It's like a wall to hide something.
The marks. This is an entrance of a tomb.
There is something here.
Look, look. إلا عن نفرتيتي.
The Valley of the Kings, the world-famous burial ground of the greatest pharaohs of ancient Egypt, and the setting for the archaeological find of the 20th century.
Carter found the golden tomb, the tomb of Tutankhamun. Look, this is the steps. When Carter found the steps, he was not sure that this tomb was intact. He excavated this corridor step by step. And he came to the second door. And that is the moment that Carter was sure that the tomb is intact.
What Howard Carter found inside stunned the world.
My perception is that when Tutankhamun died, they hired the Egyptian equivalent of a packing company, and anything and everything that was associated with him in life was packed and then crammed into that tomb.
Over 5,000 treasures, worth millions of dollars today. Epic stories of Carter's discovery inspired the young Zahi.
I live in the past, every minute in my life, thinking about something in archaeology. This is because of the passion to continue the adventure.
The name of Zahi Hawass is synonymous with Egyptian archaeology.
If he were to find an intact tomb, he would go down in the history books, much as Howard Carter has done.
For 40 years, Zahi has dreamt of finding one of the missing tombs from Tutankhamun's royal family. But where to start? 64 tombs have already been found here, and archaeologists have been scouring the area around the tomb of Tutankhamun for the last few decades, without success. Zahi's idea, to search a place that has been overlooked. Only a few hundred feet away, over a plateau, lies a little-known branch of the Valley of the Kings. The West Valley. virtually unexplored by archaeologists. And no wonder. Remote, hostile, and buried deep in centuries of rubble. It's a forbidding place, and the ultimate test of perseverance. But Zahi is convinced that this is where the lost royal tombs are hidden.
The reason that they came here, scholars never excavated here. Everyone wanted to go to the East Valley, because the East Valley had the fame, the tomb of Tutankhamun.
Zahi believes he has found a clue that could lead him to a missing tomb. An archaeologist's map from 1830 marks the outline of three huts to the north of the valley.
This map, it is the starting point for a big discovery in the West Valley of the Kings.
But first, his team has to dig through 3,000 years of debris. Zahi suspects these huts could have been used by workers on a tomb building project.
A rule for an archaeologist. If you find work on huts, there is tombs.
But Zahi needs evidence. His team will have to sift through the materials round the huts for clues.
The music of excavation. Looking, removing, discovering.
Only two finished tombs have been discovered in the West Valley. Both of them belong to pharaohs from Tutankhamun's royal line. The first, the tomb of his grandfather, Amenhotep III. And the second, the tomb of Tut's successor, King Ai.
The West Valley is interesting because we've got two identifiable tombs. You have the tomb of Amenhotep III almost immediately as you enter. You walk in a little bit of a circuitous route, and then at the very end, you have the tomb of Ai. There's an enormous expanse of space between the bookends that any number of tombs could still possibly be found.
Out of Tutankhamun's royal family, there are several members whose tombs are yet to be discovered. Zahi has his heart set on finding one in particular. The tomb of Egypt's most famous queen, Nefertiti. An iconic queen who married the son of Amenhotep III and became stepmother to King Tutankhamun. Nefertiti ruled during Egypt's golden age and became famed for her legendary beauty.
She's referred to as a living god, and she really was one of the most powerful women ever to be a queen in the 18th dynasty.
Could she have been laid to rest here, in this hidden branch of the valley?
It's absolutely conceivable that Nefertiti was buried in the Western Valley near the tomb of Amenhotep III.
Zahi is convinced.
I am sure Nefertiti is here, 100%. But where? This is the question.
Were the huts marked on the map in use in Nefertiti's time? Before long, a clue. Fragments of ancient pottery. Their provenance can reveal vital information about this site.
Pottery is very important to archaeology. Pottery can lead us to understand the function of any place.
As the team peel back the layers, more pottery is unearthed, suggesting there were workmen here. Zahi brings in his right-hand man, field director and fellow archaeologist, Afifi Rahim.
All this stuff belongs to the daily life of the workers. So it means there is a big activity in this area.
Thank you.
Aisha Mohammed Umtasar and her team catalog every item.
I receive the material here to draw it and record it and prepare everything for the study.
Each fragment will be dated and sent to the lab. The dig throws up more and more pottery, typical of the 18th dynasty.
We have to be patient and we have to keep digging to get answers for our questions.
The team wants to find out if the huts date from the time of Nefertiti. And then, among all the plain fragments, Afifi spots something significant. It's a blue pigment. A smoking gun. This ethereal shade of pale blue wasn't developed until the 18th dynasty.
All this pottery, all of this is dynasty 18.
A team of highly experienced archaeologists are rebuilding these ancient vessels, piece by piece.
So we have here many pottery shards. We try to figure out if they are connected together or not. This is a same boat. We can collect the shards together to see how the boat was.
There are some vessels here similar to what found in the tomb of Tutankhamun. I mean, the workmen who worked in this area dated 3,000 years ago from Dynasty 18.
This shade of blue is not only rare and expensive, it is associated with one of Nefertiti's closest relatives, her father-in-law, Amenhotep III. The largest of the two finished tombs in the Western Valley belongs to Amenhotep III. He was the wealthiest and most powerful pharaoh Egypt had ever seen.
This king wanted to have a unique place for his family by choosing the West Valley for his burial tomb.
Amenhotep III chose the Western Valley for his tomb because he wanted to start a new dynasty. He wanted to build his tomb as far away from the tombs of predecessors and also mark out a landscape where his sons and his daughters and the rest of the generations would be buried.
At several thousand square feet, Amenhotep's tomb is one of the largest in the Valley of the Kings and reflects his great wealth.
A very long tomb in the rock, covered with beautiful scenes of the king in front of many gods.
It's a labyrinth of corridors and chambers. On the walls, a distinctive color. Pale blue. Resembling the prized pottery associated with Amenhotep's reign.
Based on the pottery, all of it that's found in this huts is Dynasty 18. No one single pottery 19th or the 20th. And therefore, I really consider this valley as a place exclusive for Amenhotep III and his family.
Zahi Hawass and his team are 4 weeks into Egypt's biggest archaeological dig.
If anybody can find a tomb in the Western Valley, Zahi Hawass can.
They've uncovered what looks like ancient huts. Could these structures have been used by workers building a royal tomb for one of Tutankhamun's family members? Zahi hopes it will lead him to the ultimate prize, the lost tomb of Nefertiti, the most iconic queen of ancient Egypt's golden age. As excavators dig around the structures, more and more huts are revealed. It's now looking more like a street of stone dwellings, up to an incredible 30 in total.
The three houses are only three in the map. Then people thought this could be workmen huts, but never anyone knew this big extension of the discovery of 30 houses.
It's so exciting to find something like this. The walls are connected together like a street.
But to Afifi, the structures don't appear to be ordinary workers' huts.
First, we thought that all of this is just huts, but it is not normal to find another doorway and another subsidiary rooms connected with main rooms.
The houses are different from all the workmen huts that found in the East or the West Valley. They're bigger.
Zahi thinks the structures are too extensive and sophisticated to be simple workers' huts. Could they be the remains of a workman's village? Only one such settlement has been found nearby. 1 mile south of the dig lies a unique site. 3,000-year-old Deir el-Medina. Its isolated desert setting is no accident. For almost 400 years, this was home to an elite group of skilled builders dedicated to a single task: constructing the royal tombs in the Valley of the Kings.
This village is unique. It started on Dynasty 18. It has 68 houses. Look, the 68 houses, each house consists of four rooms and a kitchen.
The village of Deir el-Medina was inhabited by the workmen who worked on the Valley of Kings. And it was a community. It wasn't just the workmen, but it was also their families and their children.
Pharaohs didn't want to risk workers sharing the secret location of royal tombs with outsiders.
This is how they cook, they eat, they love, they hate. Everything is here. The rooms are really big. The houses are built of mud brick, supported with stone.
Are the 30 structures uncovered in the West Valley a second Deir el-Medina? Zahi is not convinced.
The 30 houses that we found in the West Valley are completely different. They are not rooms for the workmen to live. Permanent. I don't think that the workmen lived in the West Valley.
If they're not dwellings big enough for workers and their families, then what were these mysterious structures for? And how might they relate to a royal tomb? Afifi and the team have uncovered an unusual feature. A limestone slab with a hole, which almost certainly held a doorpost.
It's real to find a door for a hut. It means that if they put a door, that this hut could be roofed and well closed to keep something important.
This was no workman's shelter. What was going on inside these huts that was so important, it needed to be kept under lock and key? The answer may lie in the artifacts being recovered from the site.
This is a medal. We found it in huts number 16. It's made of bronze. Could be used for making some clothes for the king to put it inside the tomb. It's so rare to find something like this. I think only one needle in Luxor Museum.
There is even jewelry that might have been crafted to grace the royal mummy itself.
We have a group of beads, different colors. And also we have a big bead, but without completing the hole inside it. So it means unfinished. So maybe they were preparing necklace for the princess or the queen.
Finally, a piece of evidence which takes the purpose of the lockable huts to a whole new level. A tiny chip of black rock.
This represented the pupil inside the eye in the statues. In the old kingdom, it be rounded like a circle. But in 18th dynasty, it takes this shape. I think it's obsidian.
A volcanic rock, obsidian was used to craft the eyes of Tutankhamun in his famous death mask. It was the greatest treasure recovered from his tomb and remains the most famous Egyptian artifact in the world. To Afifi, obsidian can only mean one thing. Someone was making a royal mask in these huts. If he's right, these stone structures were a workshop making luxury items for a royal tomb.
So we have called these structures workmen's huts. I think better to call them workmen's ateliers or perhaps artists' studios where fine crafted work is being conducted, like a jeweler's shop or like a great ceramic studio.
The evidence of the artifacts prove that this area was an alfinet workshop. It is very important for the tomb to be equipped with artifacts that the king would use in Dabian.
What makes that discovery a little bit more momentous is that we've now found material in them that tell us the function of the building.
This is the first funerary workshop ever found in Egypt. Not only that, teams of artisans were crafting funeral items on an industrial scale.
You would have 30, 40 rooms that are all linked together, and each room would be in charge of a specific facet.
Suggesting luxury goods were being created for a ruler, a king or a queen. Of all the members of Amenhotep's royal line, whose tombs are yet to be discovered, only one of them was a ruler. Queen Nefertiti. In the search for the missing tomb of Queen Nefertiti, Zahi's team has made a monumental discovery. The first funerary workshop ever found in Egypt.
Finding this industrial workshop, it is unique. And it is unique for the Valley of the Kings.
3,000 years ago, this would have been a buzzing hive of industry. Teams of artisans would have crafted luxury items for a royal tomb. Furniture, vases, jewelry, items a king or queen would need in the afterlife.
Those artifacts, like gold and silver, would be stored and sealed by a door in a house like this.
We found many things that tell us that they finish funerary stuff here before it get into the tomb directly.
News of the discovery has attracted the world's press to this forgotten branch of the valley.
For the first time, we made major discoveries. Number one, we found an industrial area. 30 houses were found. Inside the houses, we found workshops for making pottery, workshop for making furniture.
The discovery is a world first, a game changer for Egyptian archaeology. And for Zahi, it signals a crucial step towards his ultimate dream.
There is a royal tomb in this area around here.
To work out where the tomb is in relation to the funerary workshop, Zahi needs to get in the mind of an Egyptian tomb builder. And to do that, he has uncovered clues written in the cliff faces of this ancient landscape. Geologist Jean-Paul Zonneveld has analyzed how Egyptian tomb builders use natural features in the rock when choosing a tomb site.
The Valley of the Kings has large-scale vertical fractures that occur at regular intervals and fault systems, most of which are related to the natural weakness of the rocks themselves.
The natural process that formed the valley left its limestone cliffs riddled with fractures.
The ancient Egyptians clearly understood the orientations of these fractures. And when they picked sites for their tombs, they were very, very careful to find the orientation of the fractures in the area.
Tomb builders knew that multiple fractures made the rock dangerously unstable.
They avoided what we refer to as fracture swarms. When you have a whole bunch of small fractures near each other, your rock's breaking into small chunks.
Finding the right sort of fracture could make the colossal task of carving a tomb out of solid rock a whole lot easier. As an unfinished 18th dynasty tomb in the East Valley demonstrates.
It's apparent that the ancient Egyptians used the natural fracture system in this mountain to aid within tomb construction. In this case right here, we can see a major fracture network that runs all the way along the roof right here towards the edge of that secondary doorway. This is really quite amazing. As they came down the shaft, they clearly used this next fracture system as a way of creating this beautiful tabular wall right here, this beautiful straight wall.
To help him identify which fracture patterns could lead him to a tomb, Zahi must get a bird's eye view of the landscape. And for that, he needs to bring in technology. Specialists will conduct an aerial photogrammetric survey of the valley to produce a highly accurate 3D map.
We're into new territory of accuracy on the scale that we're at. If we needed to, we could go down, and you'll see small stones in this giant model, so extremely high resolution model.
The data will be used to produce the first 3D model of the West Valley.
That's something really amazing. This accuracy, it didn't exist before. It is cutting-edge technology. Do they think this is all right?
Yeah, it's looking good to me.
Yeah, me too. Let's go.
The drone takes one photo per second of the entire valley. From the tops of its cliffs, to its desert floor. It's not long before the team can analyze the results. The 3D model highlights several key fracture points around the site of the funerary workshops. But Zahi is honing in on one particular area. It's a point where the valley forks, only 150 feet from the workshops. Here, a wall of evenly spaced large fractures, the type favored by tomb builders. Could this be the final resting place of Egypt's most famous queen? He relocates his 150-strong excavation team. It's a huge gamble.
When you deal with Dr. Zahi, it make me feel pressure because Dr. Zahi trust in me and it bend in me. You can't say no to him. You will just obey his order. Take a breath.
Egyptologist Zahi Hawass has just 3 months left before the West Valley's brutal summer heat will end the digging season. He has discovered the first ever workshop crafting grave goods for a pharaoh. But now, he needs to locate the lost tomb they were destined for.
When you think about it in a forensic way, truly exciting, because where you find huts, you find tombs.
To find a tomb entrance, or cut, means digging right down to the bedrock. It won't be easy. Parched desert canyons are among the most challenging places on Earth for archaeologists to work. Not because of the lack of rain, but what happens to the landscape when it does?
When rain starts, it dampens the upper level of the sediment. Clay minerals swell, and they create a surface that nothing can penetrate. There's no vegetation to hold back that water. It's a dry landscape, and so everything comes coating down these canyons. Even if only a centimeter of rain falls, we're still getting around 10 liters of water for every square meter of surface behind us. There are thousands of square meters of landscape feeding into every one of these canyons. It creates an amazing erosional force that comes through these canyons, transporting everything with it.
Repeated flooding over 3,000 years has transported millions of tons of rubble down the valley, burying the entrances to any hidden tombs. In the East Valley, Howard Carter spent 7 years clearing the valley floor before he had any chance of locating Tutankhamun's tomb. The West Valley remains how the East Valley looked a century ago, barely excavated virgin territory. Zahi must follow in Carter's footsteps and clear 3 millennia of rubble. Using the same method, muscle power. Heavy machinery is forbidden. It could destroy crucial evidence.
It needs a brave archaeologist. We are brave. The Egyptians, when they came to the New Kingdom, to choose this valley, they thought the valley is difficult. it's away from the people. You have hidden areas. It's a perfect hidden place.
A successful dig relies on a well-organized team of excavators. Leading this team, Rais Ali is one man who has archaeology in his blood.
Rais Ali spent his life excavating and moving stones. It's from a family that all their lives connected with archaeology.
I'm very happy I work inside this team. I'm working in Egypt in excavation. I worked with him long time before.
Hello, Sita.
After only a few days digging at the new location, Rais Ali stumbles on something.
I think it's not gold.
Not gold.
Maybe bronze?
Maybe bronze.
During the 18th dynasty, bronze was a highly valued material. Can the hieroglyphic engraving reveal its origin?
هنا بينا بقى رشتينا سعيد بص في الشمس
شوف انت حتى تلاحظ ان اتملت بالتراب دي باينه اللي هو ماشي 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 مع ارضيه الخاتم مع الميل بتاع الريشه اللي هي ورقه النبات لكن دي مش دي هنا عريضه ودي رفيعه هنا لانه ساحبها كده لكن دي هو خد لفه كده
We can't say anything now about the owner of this ring. We just need more cleaning. I was so happy. It was really amazing to find a big ring in this area.
A specialist in jewelry restoration reveals the hieroglyphs.
الاثنين اللي على النفر التي بص بقى هنا بص لها من كده بص يا فتحي اللي على يمين وشمال نفر مش التي بص لها من بالظبط كده هتلاقي على اللي على اليمين تي اي واي
اثنين اي
Zahi's first interpretation is tantalizing. Could this be the signature ring of the famous queen of Egypt's golden age? Nefertiti was a pivotal figure at the heart of the royal family of Amenhotep III. She married Amenhotep's son, Akhenaten, and ruled alongside him before becoming stepmother to Tutankhamun.
She was definitely Akhenaten's partner in crime and was part of his religious revolution, stood by his side through thick and thin. She's part of this long line of Egyptian queens during the 18th dynasty who really held their own.
She becomes a major, major player in any discussion of the development of that historical period, and that's undeniable.
Nefertiti most likely ruled in her own right. We also think that after Akhenaten died, Nefertiti ruled for 3 years before Tut took the throne.
Did this ring once adorn the finger of a queen? Could the ring have been dropped in the dust on the way to a tomb? In the remote western branch of the Valley of the Kings, Zahi's search for the tomb of Nefertiti is making slow progress. It's taken several weeks to clear 15 feet of rubble by hand. But the hard work has paid off. Rais Ali has made an incredible discovery.
الاثنين اللي على النفر التين.
اثنين ايه؟
ها؟
في تين.
الاثنين.
اه.
صح؟
هذا.
ايو اي ولا ايو تي؟
عندنا شك اللي على اليمين مش اي.
كنا شاكين ان دي تي.
تي.
اللي على يمينك دي.
ايو اي؟
لا تي، انا شايفها تي.
تي؟
اه.
يا راجل.
اللي هي دي.
If the ring is inscribed with Nefertiti's royal insignia, then this will be a game changer. But it's not conclusive. The second part of the symbol is a hieroglyph Zahi hasn't seen before.
Nobody can translate the title of this ring because it's a strange title. And nobody see this title before.
Afifi sends a photograph of the ring to hieroglyph experts.
We asked many specialists in the ancient Egyptian language.
Could this be the royal crest of Queen Nefertiti? Later that day, one of Afifi's sources responds with a translation of the hieroglyphs.
تستخدم والكلام ده كله واستخدم بمعنى ايه؟ بص كده بالظبط الترجمه بتاع اللقب ايه؟ The one who is united with the two masters.
It's not Nefertiti, but it is a royal title. And it is from her family. It celebrates the reign of her father-in-law, Amenhotep III. The wealthiest and most powerful pharaoh Egypt had ever known. He commissioned more statues and temples than any king before him, including the Luxor Temple. But this wasn't his greatest influence. He would be the catalyst for a religious revolution.
Pharaohs were semi-divine in life and divine in death. What does he do? He makes himself divine while alive. This is a whole new game.
Amenhotep was to become Egypt's first living god.
Here we have the god Amun-Ra seated on a throne, and we've got Amenhotep III kneeling beside him. What Amun-Ra is doing is he's bestowing his blessing on the coronation of Amenhotep III. And you'll also note Amenhotep III is wearing the ram's horn that's associated with the god Amun-Ra. He has already joined with the god and is now divine while alive.
The Luxor Temple celebrates this unification, a powerful symbol of his divine status.
Before, temples were smaller, they were enclosed. There wasn't as much space as you have here. We're in the middle of a sun court. This is about the celebration of the king joining with the sun. What Amenhotep III brings to us is a sense of theatricality, of the king presenting himself in front of the throng and proclaiming his divinity while alive.
3,000 years ago, this godlike pharaoh would have commanded a loyal following. Many of Amenhotep's family members may have worn a ring to show their devotion to their god king.
People in that time, royal and nobles, could have the name of Amenhotep III to be touched with him.
It's proof that the ring is from the right dynasty. It also confirms that workers have reached beneath the flood deposits to the precise era.
The West Valley, in my opinion, is the place that could contain all the people who are related to Amenhotep III. And this type of people should have this ring.